In this video, we're going to talk about HTTP interceptors in Angular. Interceptors allow you to hook into the HTTP call process and perform actions before the HTTP request is sent and right after you receive the response, before it is completed. Those actions could be anything like applying additional headers to your requests, returning cached data, or setting up a global loading state. Once you get a response, you probably want to handle HTTP errors, update the cache, turn off the loading state, or do many other cool things. Each interceptor is represented as a simple function that should implement a certain interface and be properly registered in your application. In this video, you will learn how to achieve that, and by the end of the video, we will have two interceptors. The first one will be responsible for appending authorization, header, and token for every HTTP request before it is sent to the server. And the second one will be a global HTTP handler that will be globally reacting to failed HTTP requests and retry the same request multiple times with a certain time interval. And if the last attempt also fails, then it will show a short snack bar message in your application. And of course, along the way, you will learn a lot of other tips and tricks. If you just started to explore this topic, then this tutorial will be perfect for you. The more advanced scenarios I will cover in the upcoming separate videos about this topic. But anyway, let's get started. For this video, we will be using a demo application that has a public page with certain Angular courses that are being fetched from the backend using the brand new HTTP resource reactive primitive. Additionally, we have an admin page where logged in admins can manage users and unenroll them if needed. There, I also use HTTP resource to fetch the list of users, and when the admin clicks the unenroll button, I use the HTTP client service to mutate user data via the patch call. Despite these two HTTP calls serving different purposes, both have one common thing. They require an authorization header and a valid token to access their server endpoints. Since we might potentially have hundreds of such HTTP calls, copying and pasting this header config is very error-prone and not scalable at all. Creating something like a proxy service for this purpose isn't a great idea as well, because it brings unnecessary, in my opinion, unnecessary abstraction layer, and it forces everyone in your team remember that secured endpoints calls should be performed through the different service that most probably have some unique API that they also have to learn, etc., etc. So I don't find it as a great solution, and HTTP interceptors are exactly the solution for such use cases. So let's go and create our first interceptor by using Angular CLI and running the following command. Once I run it, the corresponding file will be created, and if we open it, you can see the empty interceptor generated. As you can see, it is a simple function that takes two arguments, the actual request and the next function that paths the modified request to the next interceptor in the chain. And by the way, if you will be working on Angular legacy codebase, you might encounter the class-based interceptors. They work the same way as the functional ones, so the concept is absolutely the same. These class-based interceptors are just legacy approach of doing this, and I would recommend you to migrate to the functional ones once you have such opportunity. Anyway, in case your interceptor modifies the request, then you have to follow the request immutability principle. It ensures that interceptors behave the same way each time their same request passes through them. This is useful in case when a failed request is sent again, and by the way, later we will be implementing exactly this scenario. But anyway, this means that you have to clone your request before it can be modified. And fortunately, there is a special method clone that simplifies the request cloning process. So once the clone is created, you have to provide this cloned request to the next function instead of the original one. Inside the clone method, you can define what needs to be modified. As you can see, there are many options available, but since I want to set a new request header, I choose a special property called setHeaders, which allows me to provide headers as a simple key value pair. And now I would need to get somehow the authentication token from the auth service. Fortunately, interceptors are running in the injection context, which means that I can easily inject any service or injection token using the inject function, and I can get the authentication token just like that. So my interceptor is done, but to make it work, we have to properly register it in our application. The registration of the interceptor is very easy. You just have to go to your app.config.ts file, find the line where you provide the HTTP client, and inside you need to import and call a function called withInterceptors, which takes an array of interceptors that are supposed to be registered and applied to all HTTP requests in your application. And now I can go and simply remove those headers configurations from my HTTP calls for my secured endpoints inside the users list component, because this job will be done by the interceptor we just created. And you can see that if I save this change, then indeed everything remains working as before. And by the way, another quick note here. Interceptors is a feature of the Angular HTTP client, which means that interceptors will not be applying if you bypass the HTTP client. For example, if you call the native fetch function directly. HTTP resource utilizes the HTTP client under the hood. So that's why interceptors are also working with HTTP resource. All right, we just learned how to create an interceptor that allows you to modify a request before it is sent to a server. Now, let's take a look how to create an interceptor that allows us reacting to certain HTTP events in our responses. For example, errors. So let's go and create a new interceptor that will be responsible for this part of work. So let's hit enter and open the generated interceptor. This time I don't need to modify or clone a request, so I can directly pass it to the next function. And the next function here is actually a key, because this is a simple observable of HTTP events that occur during the client server communication session. And you can actually pipe the next function and get access to the emitted events and do whatever you want with them. For example, you can check what type of event it is. For that, you can import and use a dedicated enum and do checks like that. And then depending on the particular event, you can perform certain side effects if needed. Since it is a regular RxJS stream, potential errors can be caught and handled by the catch error RxJS operator. And there you can receive the HTTP error response and then do something with it, like reshape the error message or handle it somehow differently and then rethrow the modified error downstream. This is up to you. It depends on your logic and your requirements. We can also configure our stream to retry a certain failed request multiple times with a 1 second delay before the HTTP error response will be fired and we will end up inside the catch error operator. So this is how you can achieve the retry mechanism. In my particular case, additionally, I want to show a snackbar message, and for that reason, I'm going to use the snackbar service by Angular Material, which I'm going to inject inside my interceptor. But where should I trigger the snackbar creation? And this is actually a really great question, because very often I see developers choosing the catch error operator to perform things like error logging or creating snackbars, etc., etc. So very often you can see something like this, and this would work. However, what we are doing here is a side effect. It doesn't necessarily lead to errors or wrong behavior of your application, but in RxJS, it is a good practice to use pure function for most of RxJS operators. And side effects you have to perform in specific places designed for that. And one of such places is a tab operator. So since I want to perform side effect when error happens inside my stream, then I have to slightly reconfigure the tab operator and provide an object with the key error, and the value of it would be a callback function that takes the, in my case, HTTP response error as an argument, and inside the callback body, I will simply move the logic that is responsible for the snackbar creation. And it also means that since I don't do anything meaningful with my error inside the catch error operator, then I can simply remove this block since it is just useless in my case. And this is it. Our global HTTP error handler is ready to use, so let's go and register it as well inside our app.config.ts file. And by the way, please keep in mind that the interceptors will be executed in the order they are defined inside this array. So in my case, it is not relevant, but in your scenario, it might be that the order matters, so keep it in mind. And now let's go and try to test it out. For example, let's simulate the call to the non-existing URL by modifying one of the requests in the users list component. Then let's save this change and open the browser tab. And you can see here that the first attempt fails, then the second one, then the third one, and only after that we see the snackbar with the corresponding message below. Of course, sometimes you want to react differently to different types of errors. For example, if you get a 401 error because the AUTH token is expired or anything like that, you probably would like to perform a token refreshing or redirect user to the login page. In this case, you can add an additional check, additional guard, where you can check if the error code is one of the listed inside this array. And then you perform different actions depending on the error code. And if you have to react differently to certain error code, then I would recommend you to create a separate interceptor and do it there, and to not mix everything in one interceptor because it will be harder to maintain and test. All right, so this is the most essential information about HTTP interceptors in Angular. And in the next video, I will show you more advanced scenarios, and you will see how to invoke interceptors only for HTTP requests made under a certain root level, instead having them applied globally for every HTTP call in your application. Because, for example, right now our authentication header is applied even to the endpoints that are supposed to be public, which might not be the behavior you actually want. Otherwise, I would recommend you to be subscribed to my channel to not miss the next video. And meanwhile, you can check my video courses about Angular that helped already hundreds of other developers to boost their Angular skills and their careers as well. All the links you will find in the video description. And of course, I appreciate everyone who supports my channel here on YouTube or on Patreon. You guys are amazing, and by the way, you should already have an access to the upcoming video I just mentioned. Anyway, thanks for watching this video until the end. If you find it useful, please share it with your colleagues and friends. Leave your comments, leave your thoughts. I wish you a productive week ahead. Stay safe and see you in the next video.